Here's an asset that we kept reaching for whenever we wanted to add a little life into the scene. Whether it be for Eevee or the Cycles rendering engine, we wanted those little dust particles in the air, or moths, just stuff that gets caught up in that juicy depth of field bokeh to enhance the perspective in the scene. It's something we found ourselves setting up again and again, so finally we wised up and created a geometry nose setup that makes the process we kept repeating pretty easy, fast, and fun. So I've opened up the pro version of the file right now. As we can see over here, we have the main object selected, so we can see all the settings in the modifiers tab, thanks to Blender's geometry nodes. At the moment though, we can just see a load of planes, which hold the sprites for our particles. So let's switch over to rendered view, and we'll see the material that we have on the sprites at the moment, which is just the simple circle material. All the relevant materials will start with a DP plus. So to get it running in your own scene, all we have to do is go Control C and then Control V into your target file. Let's just hide this cube to make things a little easier to see. And then let's jump over to the modifiers tab. And then to get things to orient properly, we'll need to select the camera from the pull down or use the eyedropper. And then once we jump into the view camera and then start to navigate this around, we can see that even when we try to fly past them, they should still orient themselves to looking directly at the camera. Let's reset the scene and show another way to get it in, which is just simply using the file and append method. Once we've navigated to the relevant blend file, we can just click on it and then go down to the object, the circle in this case, and then click append. And then it should just be as before. I'll hide that cube again and then come over to the modifiers tab, select the camera, and then when we jump into the camera, everything should be as it was before. Plus, we should also have all the materials come with us. So at that point, we can just jump over to rendered mode, press play. Let's hide all the stuff in the viewport actually, and then zoom in a little bit. Then we should get a pretty decent result right out of the box. Just to make these particles easier to see, I'll sharpen them up a bit and then make them a little bit larger. We'll be going over the controls in just a second, but right now, let's just talk a little bit about the domain. Really, it's just as simple as using S to scale in the viewport to make the particles take up more of the scene as we scale up the domain there. And we can also use the hotkey R in the viewport to just rotate the domain, or double tap R for a trackball style rotation. All the particles should stay oriented correctly. But if we've got some non-uniform scaling, so let's go S and then Z and squash it along the Z axis, we can see that our planes are actually getting squashed. In fact, actually it's easier to see from the camera really. So to correct that, let's go Control A and then apply that scale. So we'll see actually they're still in this kind of compressed domain, which isn't very tall, but we can just jump into the camera and we can see everything should still be nicely aligned to our view. So if we're not going for that stretched out kind of look on purpose, then we probably want to use Control A to apply the scale. Here I've opened up the light version, and let's take a quick look at the controls. So at the top we've got the particle generation and where we would be aligning to our camera. Below that we've got a shading section, and then shimmer, which is kind of an extension of shading, which will add an amount of flickering to our particles. And then finally, or at least for the light version anyway, we've got the movement section. Going back up to the top of the modifier, we've got the camera selection. Here we can see an example of where I haven't actually placed the camera, and I've also created quite a lot of non-uniform scaling. So I've really stretched the particles out and then just animated a camera flying down in between these two versions. So we have this cube and then the cube.001, both without a camera set and both just using the circle material. So that's just more of an abstract kind of test. So coming down to the rest of the settings, most of the controls are sliders, which have minimum and maximum values to suggest reasonable ranges. However, some of these restrictions can be overridden, which would mean, for example, if we went all the way up to 1 on this max size, we can see it goes between 0 and 1. But if I wanted to override that, I can just type in, say, 3 instead. By the way, I wouldn't recommend doing that necessarily, because we're just stacking 150 transparent layers on top of each other, which is kind of processing intensive. So it's best to keep the particles kind of way smaller than this, really. For the same reason, we wouldn't recommend going too high on the amount, which hopefully is fairly explanatory. Basically, we have one particle in the scene now, or we can take it all the way up to 5,000. There's so many on here now, let's kind of take the size down a little bit more so we can see them a bit better and rotate around the view a little bit. But we can actually override that all the way up to 20,000, which is where we found the computer was actually starting to get really quite slow. It might look like you can go higher than that. So we can type in 30,000, for example, but we see actually nothing changed. We've capped that at 20,000 kind of behind the scenes in case it's accidentally set too high. That's where most of the potential crashes are going to come from, we think. Just like if we accidentally set a too high subdivision value on an already dense mesh, for example. If the particle limit still feels too low at 20,000, there is actually just a super simple way around it if you're sure you can handle more particles, which is just to duplicate the object and change the seed. So I've just duplicated it there. And then now let's give it a different seed, or basically random pattern of distribution. And then we can see we've now got 40,000 particles in the scene, which, as you can see, is getting harder and harder for my particular machine to handle. So I'm going to bring that down to something a little bit more manageable so that we can collectively breathe a sigh of relief. That is the graphics cards across the land anyway. We just touched on the max size a little bit, which is just going to control our overall size, of course. But we also have this minimum size, which is a percentage of the maximum. So at 1, that's basically saying 100%. So all the particles are going to be basically the same size. Some might seem a little bit bigger, but that's just because of their proximity to the camera. And if we set that all the way down to 0, it means some of the particles can be arranged between practically invisible because they're so tiny, and all the ranges in between. I'm just going to cap that so that the smallest particle can only be, say, about 25% of the max size. Next, we're coming down to the shading area. We can actually put any material that we wanted on here, but for a lot of these controls, for example, like the shimmer, we've set them, we've customized them to work with these particular DP Plus materials that we've set up, of which we've just got this one main one in the light version. So right underneath the material options, we have this use emission checkbox, and we also have this use diffuse and translucency checkbox. And the diffuse translucency is just referring to whether you want it to be affected by lights in the scene. So we actually have this light off to the side here. And if I rotate this away, you can see that the particles themselves are actually receiving the light from this. And if I zoom back in a little bit more, and we can enable the emission to use on top of that. So this is basically adding its own illumination. So this is independent of any lights in the scene. We can adjust the power of this emission with the emit strength. So we can keep cranking that up. And then this is pretty handy if you want to combine it with something like, say, bloom, and then come back over, and then we can jump down to the value variation, where this will be randomizing the brightness of each, basically. If I turn off the diffuse translucency for a second, and we come over to our color, which is tinting the particles, as we can see there, if we actually come down and set this to black, using the emission shader on its own, that's basically going to act as a kind of a transparency. So setting to black gives us zero result in the scene. If we want to be able to still see them, we'd need to enable the use diffuse and translucency. So this color is kind of going to affect strength as well as its tint. So I'm just going to set this down to something a little lower and jump over to the border feathering. This is basically just how sharp the particle happens to be. So it's pretty crisp at the moment, but we can essentially blur them out by cranking the border feathering up. Our hue variation will start to increase the spread of potential colors that we get. So the tint of slightly orange here is going to broaden its reach out into yellow and red. Or if this is all the way up, it'll go all the way around the color wheel, a little bit more like your typical confetti type of color ranges. Saturation is going to do the same kind of thing. If we have this completely fully saturated, then the saturation variation is going to randomize that. Some are going to be completely white and others are going to be still fairly saturated orange. Here I've jumped into one of the other light project files, the lantern blend file, which has these two versions of the circle sprite going on. So if we just play these, we can see we have one here and they have the other one just over there. And these are both set to translucency, so they're not using any emission. So the emit strength there isn't being used. But if we crank this up a little bit, we should start to see the particles over here are starting to blink a little bit. So let's just turn off the other particles for a second. They're blinking pretty quickly, which is derived from the speed there, so I can slow that down. And then the contrast is how quickly it fades in and out. So if we take that really high, it's going to blink basically completely on or off. Whereas when that's low, it's going to be a slower fade. And if we don't want it to go completely off, we can kind of just reduce that strength a little bit. So it's just a slight flickering, or shimmer, as we've called it. I'm just going to hide this second one, and let's take a look at the movement section. So the speed and the distance traveled somewhat speak for themselves, but they do work together. So if we set the distance traveled to be much higher, say like 20, it's going to appear a little faster because it's got to travel more distance in that same time now. Whereas the speed, we can now set that down a little bit lower to compensate, but that's a pretty high setting anyway. So I'll just set these back down a little lower again. The roughness is how chaotic the various paths are. So if we set that all the way down, you should see that they move in a really smooth way. And then as we increase our roughness, they become more and more agitated. This is definitely getting into more moth territory now, or butterfly. So I'll just take that down a little bit. The offset gives us a chance to essentially speed up or slow down the particles on top of what their paths already are. So essentially we can use this to animate. So if I scrub along this, we can see very, very precisely where each particle should be on its path. And finally, down here, we have the noise scale. The noise scale is simply how unique the path is for every particle. So lower values are great for more fluid, somehow more peaceful results, and higher values are complete independent chaos. Again, we're getting somewhat into the chaos of a moth's mind. All right, so I've jumped into a pro version and also set the camera up. And also, by the way, I've locked the camera to the view just to make the orienting around the scene a little bit more smoother. And then we can take a look at the other controls that we've got here, starting at the top with the loop start frame and the loop end frame. When you want the loop to start and when you want it to end. If the frame range goes too low, it does get a little bit chaotic. So for example, if we just set it to 1 to 10, we'll see that things go a little bit awry there. So it needs to be at least around 100, I'd say, to get something reasonable. So every 100 frames, it's going to start looping itself. We do have this loop multiplier though as well. So actually what's happening is we're seeing that loop twice. So really it's actually at frame 50 or 51 that we should see the exact same frame as frame 1. So if I jump back to 1, we could see that there was no change there. We just found this to be a quick and easy way to either rapidly speed up or slow down the whole, all of the settings. Just because we have this loop start and loop end, it doesn't mean that that's the only time that the animation will play. It will actually play beyond that frame range, but this is simply giving you the control over how many frames that you have in your looping simulation. This pro version also has more materials, so I'm going to switch over to this pollen one, for example, to show off another one of the settings that we've got here, which is the alpha contrast. This pollen material is the sort of nature seed and fluffy type sprite. So I think this is a pretty good example because it's got a lot more subtlety in the semi-transparent areas. So that's what this alpha contrast, or kind of like an alpha boost in a way, is designed to do. So it'll boost the transparent areas of the alpha map and help take full advantage of that transparent range. We also have the flare material. Let's just increase the size a little bit. This is another sprite that can benefit with a little adjustment on the alpha contrast. Once we've boosted that a little bit, maybe there's a too much of a noticeable sort of ring around everything, so we can sort of feather that back out again by just squeezing in the border, feathering a little bit on it. We've also got the moth material. I'm going to set this one up a little bit more chaotically, as is the moth way. Maybe set the size down a little bit. Take the color. Well, let's not have as much of a pronounced saturated tint to this one. That's going to allow us to take a look at some more of the controls a little bit lower, which is the random rotation. So what I'll do is I'll slow the speed completely down by just making them 0 for a second. And then we'll see the speed of our rotation at the moment is set to 2. So if we set that much higher, they'll be spinning around a lot faster. Just for a second, I'm actually going to introduce some more of the viewport overlays so that we can see this a little bit more precisely. And let's turn off the constant rotation for a second. And as we can see, that's so erratic because it's so rapid. But if I take this down a little bit, hopefully we can start to see actually what's happening there. The distance is how far it will rotate. So if we just take this down a little bit, it sort of rocks back and forth just a little bit. The higher values you get, the more it's more likely to take to do complete random flips. And the roughness would be just how much more extra jitteriness do we want to add on top of that. I'll turn the rotation speed completely off for this one and just turn this one on instead, the speed constant. And the randomization is on full. So every sprite can have a potentially different direction and constant speed of rotation. But we can turn that all the way down and have them all rotating equally the same. Here I've jumped into the Bokeh version 1 for the EV.blend within the Pro project files. We can see that this is basically working. Let's jump over to Cycles and compare. We can see we're getting these larger, softer areas, but we also get these smaller, brighter, sharply contrasted areas as well. So let's jump back over to EV and show where this is being controlled. By default, the jitter camera is off and the max size is set to, I think it's 100. And we can see that just more or less obliterates the effect. As we reduce the maximum size down, we can see that we are getting something that we can see, but everything just appears to be basically the same size, which is not really what we want. So turning on the jitter camera allows that difference in sizes that we can see now, but it really needs us to take the max size down to nothing to get that really similar to Cycles crisp type effect. Just remember that a lot of the detail that we get is going to be generated dependent on the amount of samples that we have. So we're going to want to make sure it's pretty high, like 256 or maybe even higher. Since it's very Blender specific, if you want to use some of this stuff in an external bit of software like After Effects or something along these lines, or maybe you just want to make the effect even more performant within Blender, we can render out the particles as a VFX element and then drop that into the scene or composition in any way you see fit. To do that, we'll need the output tab of the properties window. Then we'll need a decent file format that can handle our transparency, like OpenEXR or TIFF. These both usually give faster results in smaller files than PNG. I'll use OpenEXR here. Make sure it's RGBA for the alpha, and we only need 16-bit detail at the most here, so we can choose float with the half in brackets. Then give any of the lossy codecs a try. I've left it set to lossless zip here, but usually we'd go for something like the PXR24 lossy codec. In the rendered view, we can see the dark background of our world. Instead, we want to render that world as transparency. So let's go over to the render properties, find the film section and click transparent. Then we can render out our image sequence that we can use to drop as an element into DaVinci, After Effects, or Blender's VSE, or whatever we like. Here I've rendered out some moths as an example element to act as flies. They have a transparent background, but I'm showing them with a pale background so we can see them a bit better. Then we can use some footage of some nefarious character and drop in our element on top to illustrate that we believe their ideas to be less than savory. Or if you'd like to go full biblical proportions, it's totally up to you. Alright, so here I am back in the moth and the lamp scene from the project files, and what I'll do is I'll just duplicate this across so that we've got two of these in the scene. So we've got these two moth particle domains now, just so that we can show ways to alter the settings on both of these at the same time. So I'm going to shift select them both. So the first thing to know is that you can just hold Alt and then left click and drag across to create less or more moths. Another way to do that is just to right click and then copy to selected, which you can see there. Let's turn all the amounts down on one of them again. And another way we can copy across settings is to go Control L in the viewport and then choose Copy Modifiers. That's pretty handy if we've changed tons of the settings and want to copy them across all in one go. If you happen to have multiple modifiers on the object though and don't want to copy all of them across, of course, and you really just need to specify just this modifier to copy, then we can use the pull down little chevron menu here. Let's talk briefly about movement. We haven't introduced a direction flow to the particles just yet, though that is coming soon. But in the meantime, there are a couple of simple ideas we wanted to include here. One is to just simply parent the DP Plus object to a camera, as was done with the moths in this more stylized example. Here's another movement example, which we used for this scene here. It looks like the embers are all drifting up and to the left. I'll go over to the animation workspace and disable the keyframes that have been placed down here. You can see from the settings that we're just using the light version in this example. There's nothing particularly out of the ordinary in the settings there. Though by inserting a location keyframe by pressing the I hotkey in the viewport, then moving the timeline along and then moving the DP Plus object to where we want it to end up, and then keying another location keyframe, that's basically all we need to do. In this example, we've made sure that the keyframes are linear so that the object moves at the same speed all the way through the animation. We can do that in the graph editor or the timeline with the T hotkey and choose our interpolation there if we like. To sell the embers effect, we've just made sure we've got some bloom on, of course, and that goes hand in hand with a strong emission of 25 with plenty of value variation at 0.8. The motion blur really helps to stretch out our embers, and that's set pretty high. We just need to make sure we've got enough steps to smooth them out. With 8, we can see the individual samples, but with 16 and rendering again, we can see it just about gets all smoothed out. Back to the moth scene. hopefully you can now see how easy it'd be if we wanted, say, the second lamp to have just switched on, which causes one of the swarms of moths that we've got here to just drift over. It's actually really simple, but surprisingly effective. If you've got this far and you don't actually have a copy, then feel free to jump on it and get either version you like following the link. And that should wrap it up for now. Feel free to tag us if you have any experiments with it you want to share or have any feedback whatsoever, actually. I've been AD Burrows for Creative Shrimp.